Coco, your congratulations. You were great.
Thank you. And now, Eddie. Yeah. Before I go to sleep, kiss me goodnight.
What is your function?
Sometimes an old friend would drop by.
Now, I've been watching you every Sunday. Yeah. What do you do on the Ed Sullivan Show?
I introduce the acts.
I see. You introduce the acts. Mm-hmm. Now, you don't sing.
No.
You can't dance. You don't tell jokes. No. You merely introduce acts.
Uh-huh.
And you've been doing this for 19 years.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Well, Ed, if I may be so bold, and I don't like to ask this, but actually, how much do you make? I mean, how much money do you get for this particular job?
Well, Jack, I'd say approximately $800 million. $800,000. I raise it, but I'm going to cut it down.
He's reading it, and he got it wrong.
And Ed showcased the biggest names in rock and roll.
I see my riddle and I want it painted black. No colors anymore, I want them to turn red. I see the girls walk by dressed in their summer clothes. I have a new girl here to fill my darkest soul. No more will my green seagull turn a deeper blue. I could not foresee this thing happening to you. If I look hard enough into the setting sun, my love will laugh with me before the morning comes. I see my red door and I want it painted black. No colors anymore, I want them to turn black. Girls walk by dressed in their summer clothes. I have to turn my head and feel my daughter's show.
When I was a young actor in New York, doing a TV series called Hawk. I walked into my favorite restaurant, Danny's Hideaway, and I heard somebody say, "Hey, Hawk." And I turned around, and there was Ed Sullivan. He said, "How would you like to take a bow on my show?" And I said, "Ed, I don't think anybody knows who I am." And Ed said, "I know who you are." But I didn't feel comfortable doing it, so I turned him down. I've regretted it ever since. I would have loved to have been on the Ed Sullivan Show. Who wouldn't? Just to have been on the same stage with such talented artists like Nat King Cole.
Straight after being up late, I walk in my baby back home. I'm in my trouble for letter with Bonner. I walk in my baby back home. We go along harmonizing a song. I'm reciting a poem. I'll go by and give me the eye. I walk in my baby back home. She's afraid of the dark, so I have to park outside of her door till it's light. She says if I try to kiss her, she'll cry. I dry her tears all through the night, hand in hand to a barbecue stand. Right from her doorway we roam. And then it's a pleasure again. Walking my baby, talking my baby, loving my baby. I don't mean maybe, walking my baby. Bye, God.
Lipstick on your collar, toe to tail on you. Lipstick on your collar, said you were. Made me stop and
And when you went on Ed Sullivan, you know, you wanted to do something dramatic. I think one of the first times I went on, and they put down some mist on the floor, which was very stagey and very theatrical, and I loved all that, because here I was a stand-up singer, and any kind of attention that I could give to the music other than just my voice was very welcome.
Look at me. I'm as helpless as a kitten up a tree, and I feel like I'm clinging to a cloud. I can't understand, I get misty just holding your hand. Walk my way, and a thousand violins begin to play. It might be the sound of your hello, that music I hear. I get misty the moment you're near.
When you're in my arms, I'm a king on the throne. But when we're apart, I walk the streets alone. One day happiness, the next day loneliness. Love is a hurting thing. Oh, love is a hurting thing. Will love bring so much joy? Why must it bring such pain? I guess it's a mystery that nobody can explain.
And now, a Sullivan moment.
Just turn around here, Ed, and yeah. I'll tell you what you do. You just grab hold of my wrist. Yeah. And I'm going to lift you, and don't you worry. You just hold on. All right, go. No. Happy anniversary.
Dean, it's so nice to have you here on the show tonight.
Let's go.
Coming up, Roy Orbison, Jackie Wilson, and great novelty acts.
I'm delighted that Rich Little is here because he was snowed in Montreal.
I arrived one time at 10 to 8, and Ed was livid. And he said, "Where were you?" And I said, "Well, I was on the plane, and it wouldn't take off in the storm." And he said, "That is no excuse." He said, "You should have been here." And I said, "Well, Ed, I couldn't walk." And he said, "What's wrong with the car?" And I said, "Well, nothing, except I was coming from Canada." He said, "Well, you get a fast driver."
And it looked as though he couldn't make it, but he did make it, and here he is. Rich Little.
Next on the Walter Brennan and Go-Go show, we got a tremendous act for you. All right, now, which one of you guys wants to introduce it? Yeah, which one is it going to be?
Well, I'd like to take a crack at it.
No. I think I should do it. You see, I had my heart set on doing this, but I arrived here. Your time's up. I'm going to make the announcement, you see, for nothing. Holly, Dave Quack, fight! Batman, why don't you do it, Batman?
Never mind that, Robin. Just keep dancing.
Comedian Jackie Mason, come out here. Rush it up.
I'll tell you the truth. There's a wonderful thing up to you to tell you the truth. What do we? As of Elizabeth Taylor, Richard Boynton, I'll tell you the truth.
Tell you the truth, you're fired again. You know that? I can't wait for you to finish. And now, from Ohio, Dean Martin.
Well, Maria, I like a big bitch buyer's water. When you walk down the street with a cloud at your feet, that's a water. Lucky fella.
Hold. Let's Jimmy Stewart here. Let's keep it kind of quiet here, because my friend Kurt Douglas, you see, he doesn't like too much noise here, do you, Kurt?
Yeah, nothing makes me more sick than my stomach. Well, that's a miserable truth. That's right. I got more important things to worry about, Bert. I want to be number one. I want to be on top. I want to be champion. I want to get my teeth fixed.
This man is definitely not for my Peace Corps. My fellow Americans, I come here tonight with a heavy heart. We must do something to end the problem in this great land of ours. So I have decided to take the following step.
Just fine, just fantastic. Now, my little Italian friend from Italy, Topo Gigio, come on, rush out here. Well, hi there, Topo.
Hello, Eddie.
What is it? Hurry up, what is it?
Kiss me good night.
We don't have time, let's hear it. He's all right, little son of a gun. He's all right. Now,
Mr. Richard Milhouse Nixon.
The polls say I'm ahead. I hope it's just not one of those Polish jokes. Let me just say this. A lot of people have said that I do not like Lyndon Johnson. I worship the quicksand this man walks on. And I don't have anything against Governor Rockefeller and his wife Happy and their future children Dopey, Sneezy, and Grumpy.
You remember when you were back in school, there were lots of girls who were double-jointed. Turned themselves into human pretzels. And there were some guys who could spit out of both sides of their mouth at the same time. Well, did you ever wonder what happened to them? Well, I'll tell you. When they grew up, the women bought themselves tutus and fishnet stockings, and the men bought silk shirts with big puffy sleeves. And then they rehearsed, got their acts together, and they went on the Ed Sullivan Show.
Day Martilli. Trio Hoganas. Bobby Winter. Thank you.
go. The Joe Slack Trio.
Very much like the living room that I grew up in. I was a teenager in the 1950s. Same beautiful brown furniture, sunburst clock, a lot of them around. This is part of my own personal record collection. Speedo by the Cadillacs. That's the record I learned to dance to. I had to use a door because my sister said, "Get away from me." Oh, they often call me Speedo, but my real name is Mr. Never understood what that meant. Penguin's Earth Angel. It's my own personal favorite, Goody Goody, by Frankie Lyman. Frankie Lyman was just 14 when he recorded this hit single.
Thank you.
could die. Bye-bye, my love, goodbye. There goes my baby. There's a long one there. She sure looks happy. I see her as blue. She was my baby.
Another Sullivan moment.
No. Mr. Sullivan plays the drums.
No.
You play the piano.
You don't play the clarinet.
You
play the
guitar.
Pepe, you can't play the clarinet.
I love the drums.
When we return, classic comedy and the best of Broadway.
The 50s seemed to deliver the post-war American dream. For most, there was enough food and shelter and work and more leisure time than ever before. As the decade passed, television became increasingly popular. The magical box brought top entertainers into our living rooms, and Ed Sullivan presented what people at home wanted to see.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we come into the comedy sequence of the show, and quite an unusual comedy sequence because of the stature of the stars involved.
Every time I come on this shoe, it's become part of the language, you know. I figure, well, I'm running out of material. But my wife, she keeps coming up with new things. Well, like I've been reading about brainwashing and psychological warfare. If the scientists want to come to my house for 2 weeks, my wife will show you how to pick a brain apart. Destroy a human being without even trying. That's what kills me when I read about the weaker sex.
You women are so strong.
Really, did you ever read any statistic? Women live longer than men. There's a reason for it. They're not married to women.
Oh, let me tell you something. I have a husband. I must tell you about my honeymoon with him because he is the sweetest guy. We had reserved a honeymoon suite in a very nice hotel. And right after the wedding, I went up and I got into it. You know, I went into my room, he was in his room. And I got into this negligee, beautiful chiffon. I wanted to look as pretty as I could possibly look. And I brushed my hair and I put mules on my feet. And I thought, well, better get in that room tonight unless you want to annul the marriage. So I started back in, and when I saw him, I stopped it. He never looked more virile, more masculine in his life. Handsome, his hair was slicked down, he had a pipe in his mouth, a maroon smoking jacket on, and bedroom slippers and white silk pajamas. Oh, he looked so nice, I hated to wake him. I went over, I shook him, I said, honey, it's your wife. He said, quick, hide me.
Now you take my wife, please. My wife is never happy with the housework. I bought electric iron, electric dishwasher, electric dryer. She said too many gadgets around the house, she had no place to sit down. What did I do? Bought her electric chair. She's crazy about furs. We found a furrier who does his own breeding. He crossed a mink and a gorilla. Got a beautiful fur coat, but the sleeves are too long. My wife went to the beauty parlor. She got a mud pack. For 2 days, she looked nice. Then the mud fell off. She puts that cold cream on at night with a trowel. And she put those iron curlers in her hair. Puts a fishing net over the whole thing. She says, kiss me. I said, take me to your leader.
Isn't it amazing when you're pretty? Look, I need nothing. I don't even wear hardly any makeup at all. Look at this face. Do you want to know there are only two things I even use? Silly putty and sandpaper. And exercise. I'm a very firm believer of exercise. I mean, that's how I stay firm, you know? I have a wonderful tip for you ladies out there. Really, listen to me. I do this exercise 1 hour every day. Look at this. Look how thin my fingers are over there.
Here's our favorite gal friend, Phyllis Diller.
I was very proud of that look that I invented, the fright wig, the gloves, and in those days I had a cigarette holder. I think looking funny, a little off, just a little off, although chic, but a little off helps.
Would you believe that I once entered a beauty contest? I must have been out of my mind. I not only came in last, I got 361 get well cards. Now, I don't want you to get the idea that I have given up on my looks. I will never give up. I am in my 14th year of a 10-day beauty plan. When I go to bed at night, I've got so much grease on my body, I wear snow chains to hold up my gown. We've got more grease stains in the bedroom than we got in the garage. One night, I asked Fang to kiss me goodnight. He got up and put on his work clothes. You know, the lights have gone out with dirty old Fang. The last time there was a gleam in Fang's eye, there was a short in his electric blanket.
People adore Fang. They're very interested in him. He has such a wonderful reputation. In a rotten way. I mean, he's the eternal idiot. In all of us, you know.
All he cares about is football. I thought that our weekends after we were married would be a loaf of bread, a jug of wine, and love. You know how it turned out? A box of pretzels, a can of beer, and the Green Bay Packers. You wouldn't believe the way this man boozes. He can kill a six-pack during an instant replay. His breath is so bad, the dentist works on him through his ears.
Some of Broadway's finest productions were dazzling theater audiences just as The Sullivan Show hit its stride. As a former Broadway columnist, Ed never lost his love of the theater, and he often attended Broadway openings with his wife, Sylvia. I remember one of those opening nights very well. It was the Broadway production of Hugh Wheeler's Look We've Come Through, directed by Jose Quintero. And
I opened the act, laughing. Well, I was looking down, laughing. The curtains parted, and I looked at the first row, and I was laughing, and I... My gosh. It was Natalie Wood. And Warren Beatty. And Ed Sullivan. And what the heck is my line? So I just laughed. And finally, God took pity on me and said, here's the line, son. Well, people actually came backstage and said, brilliant moment, the way you sustained that laugh before the first line. And I said, nothing. There's nothing. There are some genuinely brilliant moments that Ed took from Broadway to the Sullivan stage.
As long as life is long, I'll love him, right or wrong. But he's so big and strong. Someone else needs me. Child with no one to take his part. I'll take his part, Bill, but cross my heart.
My Fairly. You've heard it on Columbia Records. You've heard it in hotels, in nightclubs, on disc jockey programs, and on your car radios. So here from My Fair Lady is the English star Stanley Holloway and two of his chums, Gordon Dilworth and Rodney McLennan, in their rousing With a Little Bit of Luck. So let's hear it for them.
The Lord above gave man an arm of iron so he could do his job and never shirk. The Lord above gave man an arm of iron, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, someone else will do the blinking work. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, you'll never work. The Lord above made liquor for temptation, to see if man could turn away from sin. The Lord above made liquor for temptation, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, when temptation comes, you'll give right in. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit of luck, you'll give right in.
I was in the audience at Majestic Theater on December 3rd, 1960, for the premiere of a new musical by Lerner and Lowe. It went on to win 4 Tonys and become a major motion picture, and one of the most beloved musicals of all time. What I remember most were the two leads. The actress was magic that night and was to later become a very dear friend of mine. And the voice and presence of the lead actor kept the audience spellbound. Here's the only visual recording of Richard Burton and Julie Andrews singing the title song from Camelot.
Camelot. Camelot, I know it sounds a bit bizarre, but in Camelot, Camelot, that's how conditions are. The rain may never fall till after sundown, by 8 the morning fog must disappear. In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happily ever aftering than here in Camelot.
I hear it never rains till after sundown. By 8 the morning fog must disappear. In short, there's simply not a more congenial spot for happy ever aftering than here.
is rather frightening, isn't it?
Well, I must confess, Your Ladyship, it did occur to me, but now not marrying seems infinitely more terrifying.
A Sullivan Moment.
Comedian Albert Brooks and the Beatles' American television debut.
You know, Bert, the ventriloquists are my favorite part of the show.
They are?
Yep. This is where the real great talent comes in, so you can go out.
Is that so?
Yes, sirree.
Well, you forget, if it weren't for me, you wouldn't even be here.
Yes, I would.
No, you would.
Yes, I would.
No, you would. No, you would. Yes, I would. There's a lot of things I learned from the Ed Sullivan Show.
No, you didn't.
So I faked it. Sue me.
Any schmuck can learn how to be a ventriloquist.
I honestly?
Are you ready for your first lesson?
Yeah. Very, very funny.
No, it's a lot of fun. It's educational.
Yeah.
You want to try it?
Yeah, I think it would be fun. Sure, come on. Let's have a go at it.
It'd be fun, but, you know, it's pretty difficult. You have to learn how to talk without moving your mouth.
Yeah, not like him.
Oh, shut up. If you want to give him lessons, go ahead.
Okay. Right. Solomon, the first thing that you got to do when you're a ventriloquist, you got to put a big smile on your face. I'm working against impossible odds.
Oh, I see. You mean like this?
Yeah, now that didn't hurt, did it?
Not much.
Look, Mommy, no cavities. Solomon smiled. Another face on television.
No, Gianni, no.
No?
No.
Why?
It is very difficult.
Easy.
Easy?
Yes.
No?
No?
No, 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 no. Very confusing music.
Difficult.
I say difficult?
Yes.
Yes.
Very easy.
I say very difficult, Gianni?
Yes.
Yes.
Easy.
I say difficult?
Yes.
Yes. Say difficult.
Difficult.
Louder.
Difficult.
Louder.
Difficult.
Louder.
Difficult.
Louder.
Difficult.
Good. Very difficult.
For you, for me, very easy.
You feel good?
No.
No?
No.
Somebody told me you cast cold last night.
This morning.
This morning?
Yes.
Fever?
Yes.
Fever, let me see. Fever, no.
No,
no.
No,
sure, no. Open your mouth, please. Let me see your throat. Can you open a little more? Little more? Not too much.
While I'm close up to you. Say a good look at you, 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 a good look at you. You can't do it, can you? It never has been done, ladies and gentlemen. It's impossible, but I can do it. Watch me. I've got to look there. Which one's the dummy?
Certainly a pleasure being here on the Ed Sullivan Show. Danny, we got paid already. What did you do with your money? Well, Dave, I went out and bought myself a bicycle. You bought yourself a bike, huh? Yep. Do you have to pedal it? No, I don't. No, no. then it must be a motorbike. No, it's not. No. Just a minute now, Danny. I'm not the dummy. You're the dummy. If you don't have to pedal it and it's not a motorbike, how do you get anywhere? Well, I don't have to pedal it, but I don't have to get anywhere either. Oh, Danny. You know, I got to admit, Danny, I'm a little nervous. This being our first time on the Ed Sullivan Show and everything. Well, why don't you have a cigarette? That always calms you down. Well, I just can't have a cigarette and leave all these people sitting here. They might get bored. I'll sing a song while you have a cigarette. Good idea. What are you going to sing? Swanee River. Great. You ready? Ready anytime you are. Go.
Way down upon Swanee River.
I love Albert Brooks. You know, making your debut on national TV can be very scary. Mr. Sullivan didn't make it any easier. At the rehearsal of Jack Jones's debut, he said to the singer, "Your father was Alan Jones, wasn't he?" And Jack Jones said, "He still is." Well, I got a big laugh. So Ed said, "Oh, I'll screw that again. We're live." So after Jack Jones had finished his segment, Ed called him over and said, "Isn't your father Alan Jones?" Jack Jones said, "Yes." Well, of course, the audience didn't laugh. Although it was explained to him several times, Ed never got it. Fortunately, other debuts went a lot more smoothly.
Let's turn back the clock to 1948.
On his very first show, Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein made their television debut, as well as a sensational new comedy team, Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis. Unfortunately, there is no film of the first show, but other memorable debuts do exist.
Down the way where the nights are gay and the sun shines daily on the mountaintop, I took a trip on a sailing ship, and when I reached Jamaica, I made a stop. But I'm sad to say I'm on my way, won't be back for many a day. My heart is down, my head is turning around. I had to leave a little girl in Kingston town. Sad to say, I'm on my way, won't be back for many a day. My heart is down, my head is turning around. I had to leave a little girl in Kingston town.
Right. Colonel Tom Parker and Elvis Presley have sent us Hank Williams Jr., the 14-year-old son, to sing some of his dad's country music hits. So let's have a fine welcome for this youngster.
You're cheating heart will make you weep. You'll cry and cry and try, but sleep. Your cheating heart will tell on you.
Sullivan and the people with him were the first people to realize the power of television to reach youth. By putting the Beatles on that show, they took two tremendously powerful forces and put them together, and they heterodyned each other and just made it something five times as powerful. Do you know anybody who didn't watch that show? We'll be right back.
some hair-raising moments, and Elvis's classic Hound Dog.
Fitting the Sullivan Show into an hour was one of the biggest problems Ed had to face. He once booked an elephant act, and after rehearsal, Ed said to the trainer, "Running a little over, so could you cut something out of your act?" And the trainer said, "It's taken 20 years for this elephant to get this routine down." And Ed said, "Well, just tell him to take the middle trick out." The trainer looked at his 7-ton elephant and then back at Ed and said, "You tell him." Ed didn't say anything to the knife throwers. He let them have as long as they wanted. Most of the suspenseful moments on the Sullivan Show were intentional, but every now and again there were unexpected problems. The most terrifying moment on the Sullivan Show occurred in 1957 during Clyde Beatty's Animal Act. The renowned trainer complained to Ed that during rehearsal that the stage was too small. He'd be forced to work dangerously close to the lions. But Ed convinced Beatty to go on. Beatty's worst fears were realized when he lost control of the big cats. Ed Sullivan didn't quite know what to do, so he headed into the audience and introduced celebrity guests.
Here is an Academy Award-winning star of many times over. You probably saw him last week on What's My Line? Stumped everybody. Walter Brennan, one of the great stars of American... I know that there's one particular person out here tonight observing this display by Clyde Beatty with a great deal of interest because he knows a little something about animals himself. In fact, yesterday aboard one, he won the Preakness. Here is jockey Eddie R. Carroll.
Fortunately, Beatty was able to subdue the lions by firing blank gunshots. Ed was lucky, too. After the show, Beatty didn't skin him alive.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's so nice to have had you here tonight. I'd like to call out to you a warning that tonight, and this goes for all of you guys if you're driving cars, to drive carefully. As chairman of the National Chairman of the Safety Council, I can call on you to do that. But just a year ago, we had a pretty bad accident ourselves.
In August of 1956, at the height of his career, Ed was traveling to his weekend getaway in Connecticut to be with his family. He was involved in a severe head-on collision. Fortunately, Ed's injuries were relatively minor, but he was hospitalized and off the air for 5 Sundays.
When this dreadful accident happened, most everybody in show business immediately volunteered to fill in for Ed. This is the affection he holds with the people in show business as well as the people around the country. However, I live just a few floors above Ed, and they got to me first.
Comedian Red Skelton, actor Kirk Douglas, singer Patty Page, and Charles Laughton all filled in for Ed. Very few people remember that it was Charles Laughton who introduced Elvis on his first Sullivan appearance.
And this, by the way, is the first time in record-making history that a singer has hit such a mark in such a short time. At the very first opportunity, Ed Sullivan will award these gold records to him personally, but now it's time to meet the singer I've been talking about, and so Away to Hollywood.
Thank you, Mr. Lawton. Ladies and gentlemen. Well, this is probably the greatest honor that I've ever had in my life. There's not much I can say except it really makes you feel good. And we want to thank you from the bottom of our heart.
In the 50s, Ed feuded with some of television's top names.
I had nothing against Ed personally. He seemed like a nice, average guy. And he had that kind of masculine Irish charm, the kind certain detectives have. Ed did have this competitiveness, but the booking of Elvis on my part was a pure accident. When I first saw Elvis, I knew that he had something fascinating about him. So I told the people at my office, let's get him for our new program. We had our own comedy company, and we created comedy sketches. And indeed, when I used Elvis, I used him in a comedy context. When he sang Hound Dog, I had him sing it to an actual dog, and I had him dressed like Fred Astaire in white tie and tails.
As I've heard you rehearse it, you're going to record it tomorrow, called Hound Dog. I got you a very cute little hound dog right here. And away you go.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never gonna ever have, you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a
hound dog. On Sullivan, Elvis really rocked out.
This darn thing out, you know, he just does this and everybody yells.
There is the tradition in show business, I don't know how far back it goes, certainly into vaudeville at least, and perhaps English music halls before that, that it's nice if an act can somehow bring the master of ceremonies into the act. Now, in the case of Ed, who could not play an instrument, so far as I know, it was a little bit more of a challenge to work him into it, and it's the kind of thing that I think made him endearing to viewers.
Come on here, sit down, Ed. I deeply appreciate it.
Now, we have to start with a very simple procedure.
Mm-hmm.
Just remember these two notes right here, the two white ones next to these two blacks. Just put your fingers there.
I see them.
Good. Now, when I tell you to start, all you have to do is this. Perfect. Okay.
That's all?
Yeah, okay. Perfect.
Still to come, Bob Hope, Rudolph Nureyev, The Birds, Love and Spoonful, and Tina.
Ed grew up in the shadow of New York City. At the age of 20, he gave up his ambitions of a professional boxer and became a sports reporter for the New York Evening Mail. He maintained a lifelong interest in sports, emceeing charity events, engaging in his favorite pastime, golf, and bringing the greatest sporting figures onto the Sullivan stage.
Top golfman of the year, Sam Snead. Ladies and gentlemen, Jack Dempsey. So let's hear it. Willie Mays.
Wilt Chamberlain.
Babe Diddleton.
Rocky Marciano.
And this is Mickey Mantle.
15-year-old sophomore, Lou Alcindor.
Joe Lewis.
Jimmy Brown.
Joe DiMaggio.
Ted Williams.
Ben Hogan.
And
Jackie Robinson. What position should the bat be, you know, if for these youngsters? Mm-hmm. Where, when at the top of the swing, where should they be?
Well, I think if you watch the good hitters, Ed, they have their bat all the way back so that they don't start here and then go back. They get it back and they swing from here.
John, I didn't pick out that bat.
I think that there are just a few fundamentals in a golf swing, and I'll go over them very quickly. One is, of course, keeping the head in a very steady position over the ball, not moving off the ball at any time, keeping the eyes right on the ball, and, of course, getting the club away from the ball properly.
I know that your next heavyweight opponent is going to be Doug Jones. You're going to fight him on March 13th, and poetically, you've said where? What?
Well, Doug Jones presently is ranked number 3 in the top 10 heavyweights of the world. I'm ranked number 2. I understand that Jones like to mix, but he must fall in 6.
He must fall in 6. Now, you mark that down. You mark that down. Now, you did the same thing with Archie Moore. You call around. Suppose I were to box you. How far would I go?
Well, Ed, if you run, I'll have to cut it to 1. One punch.
No!
When the great boxing champion, Sugar Ray Robinson, faced financial difficulties and decided to go into show business, Ed was the first to promote him. Despite his tough exterior, competitive nature, and driving ambition, Ed had a soft spot for athletes and ex-vaudevillians who had fallen on hard times. He went out of his way to present them on a show, thereby giving them a little extra cash and restoring, if only for a moment, some of their former glory. How can you forget this guy, he'd say? He's paid his dues. This was never more evident than Ed's compassion for the great tap dancer, Bill Bojangles Robinson. Robinson became an international star late in life when he co-starred with Shirley Temple in The Little Colonel. Robinson died in 1949 after spending the last years of his life giving hundreds of benefit performances. Sullivan, who had befriended Bojangles in their vaudeville days, paid for the funeral and made sure Bojangles was buried with respect and the dignity he deserved. A host of celebrities, including Ethel Merman, Danny Kaye, Jimmy Durante, and Jackie Robinson came to pay tribute. They, along with 500,000 New Yorkers, lined the streets to bid a final farewell to the honorary mayor of Harlem. Sullivan continued Bojangles' legacy by frequently presenting outstanding dancers. for the first time, American audiences delighted in the brilliance of Rudolf Nureyev and Margot Fonteyn.
First adaptation of Sweet Charity from Knights of Cabiria, the Italian movie. The idea for that number, for the form of that number, came from Neil Simon. That she would want something to prove to her girlfriends, because we were all these fifth-rate dance hall hostesses, that she'd actually spent the night with Vittorio Vidal. So she wanted all of these things from him. Autographed pictures, a cane, a hat.
I've had a cold, but let's have a go at it anyway, huh?
When Irish eyes are smiling, sure it's like a morning spring. In the lilt of Irish laughter, you can hear the angels sing. When Irish hearts are happy, all the world seems bright and gay. But when Irish eyes are smiling, joy steals your heart away.
When we return, Creedence Clearwater, Richard Pryor, Tina Turner, and more.
Now remember now, when I introduce them, you're going to make a lot of noise. And you're going to be quiet so the country can enjoy them, too. Be quiet. Quiet. You promise. Ladies and... Quiet! Quiet or I'll go up there and crash you. Sal, Steve, Joe, and John, the Lovin' Spoonful. Come on!
Thank you. great big bells high up in the Catholic Tower. I mean, Catholic Tower, they
made
ring.
A mistake.
My brother made a mistake. He said showers. My brother said Catholic showers.
I didn't mean it. Tommy, it was an accident.
You
I,
said
I'm
it.
Sorry.
You said it real clear.
I know,
I heard
but
you.
I corrected
when
myself.
Did you first realize that you said it?
Right away.
Yeah, so did I. I think everybody realized you said Catholic showers. Do you know anything at all about the Catholics?
No.
They'll get you. Right, Ed?
We came on and we were singing all this kind of revolutionary rhetoric and they didn't know about that and that was kind of dangerous. And then we had this attitude and what are these guys about, you know, and they were, and we spooked them.
Take me for a trip upon your magic twirling ship. All my senses have been stripped and my hands can't feel to grip and my toes too numb to step. Wait only for my boot heels to be wandering. I'm ready to go anywhere. I'm ready for to fade onto my own parade. Cast your dancing spell my way.
Cool with a cigarette, because ladies are impressed by guys that smoke cigarettes for some weird reason. And you can really impress them, like you see them, and you lay those eyes on them, you know.
At the national weather map. There it is, man. Our weather tonight is dominated by a large low pressure center. A lot of people have written in and asked, what is a low pressure center? This is a low pressure center. This is a Canadian low, which is not to be confused with a Mexican high. Now overnight, this low will break up into a series of smaller lows. One for everybody. And now the complete national weather map, clear.
Life's a good job in the city, working for the man every night and day. But I never lost one minute of sleeping, worrying about the way things might have been. Big wheel, keep on turning. Round there, keep on turning. Rolling, rolling, rolling down the river. They got no money.
Right back with his favorite moment from The Sullivan Show.
We've seen some wonderful performers the past couple of hours, but I've saved my own personal favorite for last. This guy kills me. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the greatest magicians of all time, the amazing Ballantyne.
First the simple tricks, then I move into the more difficult tricks, then I pack up all the stuff and head to Camden. The magician, that's what the old black rag says, the magician cuts the piece of rope in half. Two pieces. God, this kid's dynamite. Where do they find this kind of talent on a Sunday evening? In the alley, that's where. A few passes over the basket. Simple trick of sticking the two hunks of rope back together again. Keep your eyes on the two hunks of rope. You know a better way? There, but they're sober. There it is, cleverly done. Together. Whoops, wrong rope. Always what I want to do good for my probation officer. Okay, who played around with the stuff back there? How jealous can you get? I'll tell them what happened. I ain't afraid. Some crumb back there cut them both. What do you think I am, a magician?
In a moment, Sammy Davis Jr. and the finale of the show.
The only thing I'd like to do is to resurrect Ed Sullivan, go back on his show, and sing the way I sing today, as opposed to how this frightened kid that was on at the time.
It was fascinating to watch. It was extraordinary, because you could see performers that there was no way you could see them otherwise.
He was kind of like a wind-up toy in a way, almost like a puppet, you know, and larger than life, but very, very complex.
Television was young, and he just happened to be the right person with the right kind of interest in entertainment.
He had a certain something about him, you know, and he was a showman. And boy, you just knew, you know, that it was him. There was only one of him.
By simply booking several of the best available acts every week for over 20 years, he has given us a museum, a library of what was the best in show business, and that's no small accomplishment.
Sullivan?
Sullivan? Yeah. Good friend, eh? Nice person. Diverse. He very intelligent, very dynamic, very serious.
Everything good.
Everything good.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. Nice kiss. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I started out wondering why, of all people, Ed Sullivan was able to maintain such a classic show for so many years. Now I think I know. He was a great showman. He appreciated talent. And most of all, he loved what he did. Not a bad recipe for success. Thanks, Ed.
Everything that happens in life can happen in a show. You can make them laugh. You can make them cry. Why, anything can go. The clown with his pants falling down, or the thrill when you're headlining the bill, or the glow when you've seen a good show. That's entertainment. Oh, a show that is really a show will send you out with a kind of a glow, and you'll say, as you go on your way, the world is a stage. The stage is a world of entertainment.
Well, come on.
The show is over. I gotta go. Show is over. I gotta go. Try it by yourself once. If you just pay
the show is over. We gotta go.
No, this is why you lost the column. Wait a minute. The show is over. We gotta go. Show is over. We gotta go. Now, the show is over. We gotta go.
Good night.
Travel provided by Continental Airlines, voted best North American transatlantic carrier by the readers of Executive Travel Magazine. Continental, with daily nonstops to Europe.
Fun is what it's all about. The Late Show with David Letterman. Tonight, movie mavens Siskel and Ebert, the music of White Zombie, and more. Now, your local news.
Mike has the night off. Here's what Ken Owen and I are covering this evening. Neighbors pitched in to help firefighters who are battling flames and heat exhaustion in a blaze on the city's east side today.
And an Ohio man leads police on a high-speed chase through two counties, and a police camera records the pursuit. Those stories, and Steve Bray looks for a break in the heat wave next on News 8.